through. Whatever you need from the Lord, say God is coming through. If it's healing in your body tonight, everybody say God is coming through. I want the whole house to sing tonight. Everybody say God is coming through.
blessing to be in the house of the Lord one more time. I'm in a good mood this morning. I'm great mood this morning. Thank you, God, for being in a good mood. I'll be reading the scripture this morning. I'll be coming from Matthew, the 21st chapter, the 18th through the 22nd verse. Now in the morning, as he returned into the city, he hungered. And when he saw a fig tree in the way, he came to it and found nothing thereon but leaves only, and said unto it, let no fruit grow on thee henceforward forever. And presently the fig tree withered away. And when the disciples saw it, they marveled, saying, how soon is the fig tree withered away? Jesus answered and said unto them, verily I say unto you, if ye have faith and doubt not, ye shall not only do this which is done to the fig tree, but also if ye shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed, and be thou cast into the sea, it shall be done. And all things whatsoever ye shall ask in prayer, believing, ye shall receive.
Thank God for his word. Amen. Lord, I'm grateful. absolutely right.
Yeah.
love you.
How I love you.
How I lift.
How I lift.
High my voice.
High my voice.
With your praise.
With your praise.
Holy Spirit.
Holy Spirit.
I implore thee. Oh!
to think about all God has done, and that we are forever to worship Him. And how many of you know that this is just a rehearsal? If you can't get it together down here, how do you think you're going to be able to do it in heaven, which is a perpetual worship service? I just want you to take a few minutes just to think about it, that I am constrained by His great gospel. How many of you know that it is the gospel that pulled us in? It was the gospel that reeled us into salvation. It was the gospel. I am forever. Have you thought about forever? It never stops. If you're grateful for an eternal resting place called forever, come on and raise your hands. Because we are compelled and constrained to worship Him forever. Whether we feel like it or not, it is a command. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Forever. into your body. He had no other design plan for you but for you to worship him. When he said, let us make man in our image and our likeness, with our characteristics, there was a praise and there was a worship that was implanted into us. And how many of you know he said, if you don't do it, I'll cause the rocks to cry out. He said, if you don't do it, I'll cause the rocks to cry out. So what he's saying into that everything that I made, everything that I created, everything that I said was good, it should worship me. I'm the only God. I know that we went through a hard weekend. But to die in him is to be with him. And we're moving on because I know that mother would tell us, y'all keep on praising him. Keep on worshiping him. Keep on doing what you got to do. If you want to be where I am, you got to worship him. If you want to see heaven. Oh yeah, put your hands together. For an almighty God, for all loving God, and all knowing God, and already God, and everywhere present God. You may not realize it. You may be mad because of some things that went on in your life. But I guarantee if you keep on living, he'll reveal it to you better by and by. Just keep on serving him. Keep on serving him. Keep on loving him. He's a way maker. He's a way maker. He's a way maker. Yes, he is. He's a heaven of shadow. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. He's a young breaker. Yes, he is. 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 He said, is there anybody in here that's gonna worship me this morning? No matter what it looks like, no matter what it looks like, we were created to worship him. Hallelujah. He deserves. His creation needs to let him hear and see the signs that we appreciate him for everything that he's done. This is his service, people of God. This is his house, people of God. And we are his creation. And he's worthy. Listen, listen, listen. I came to welcome. You can have your seats. I know you guys are different than me, but if I had to stand up all day and all night, I would do it for my God. I would do it for him because I know it was nobody but him. I have no doubt in my mind that it was nobody but God that kept me from death's door. It was nobody but God that kept my mind in perfect peace, whose mind was stayed on him. It was nobody but God. When I had a spirit of heaviness, he allowed praise to come forth. I'm not confused about who it is I belong to. I came to welcome the visitors, but I'm an exhorter. I'm a pastor and I'm an exhorter. And I love to feel God's presence anywhere and everywhere that I can feel him. And so I welcome you, all of our visitors that are here in the house today. If you're here, you can wave your hand if you're visiting. You can wave your hand so that we can welcome you. Amen, amen, amen. We welcome you, we welcome you. Hey, sweetheart, amen. We welcome you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we welcome you here to have a good time in Jesus. We don't want to put limits on him because we don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. And so we give God time to move how he needs to move within our service because God came to meet us here. So we welcome you into our service. We welcome you here to the Gift of Life where Bishop Brian is our bishop and I am senior pastor, and I welcome you here. We believe nothing but Genesis to Revelations. We don't add one thing to it and we don't take one thing from it because the word is ever powerful and it's always going to be right. Amen. Amen. So we welcome you online. We welcome you into our services this morning. If you're online, we want you to feel welcome. We pray that you entered into praise and worship with us and begin to worship God. And I thank God because he's omniscient. And he said he can be everywhere present at the same time. So as we are feeling him here in the sanctuary, you can build a sanctuary anywhere that you are. And so in your house today, we want you to build a sanctuary and invite the King of Kings in, and invite the Lord of Lords in, and invite the Everlasting Father in to come in and sup with you. I want you to prepare a table for him so he can come in and sup with you. He has no other delight than to come in and share bright bread with you. I pray healing in your body. While you're sick and shut in, it's a time for you to call on him and wait on the Lord and be of good courage, because I know he will strengthen thine heart. Oh, glory to God. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. We thank God that he has kept you. That's far for those of you that are members over the highways in other states. How many of you know that God can be everywhere? Present at every day, doing all that he does, because he is almighty. We want you to feel God right in here. Right in your atmosphere, right in your living room, right in the bathroom. We want you to feel Jesus. We didn't come here to look at each other, but we came to give God a praise. We came to expect something. We came to impart life. We came to give you the gift of life. And that more abundantly, because that's where you tuned in this morning. That's why you tuned in. You tuned in to the Gift of Life. So we welcome you here. We want you to feel right at home. When you feel right at home, you kick off your shoes. You take off the tight stuff because you're ready to fellowship with those that you love. Listen, I came on fire this morning. We welcome you. We welcome you. We welcome you. Do me a favor in this house. Just say, God, have your way. Come on, say, God, have your way. Y'all got to say it one more time for me. God, have your way. Have your way. We give God permission to come in and wreck us. We give everybody leave from service getting everything that they need. And that God would have their way in their lives. There's lies weighing in the balance. And we need to give God permission to have his way. Listen, I want you to get your have your way money together. And that means your tithe and your offering. I feel God. I feel him in the atmosphere. I feel him down in my belly. And I know that he's here. If you have your tithes and your offerings, we're asking that you would get them together. Do not be a robber or a thief unto the one who owns the cattle on a thousand hills, who has everything that we need. And when we realize that we can unlock that key, unlock that lock in heaven to a surplus supply, we won't have any problem paying our tithes and our offerings. Because you can't beat God's giving. No matter how hard you try. You can try to outgive God, but I know you don't have an unlimited resource without God. So if you have your tithes and your offerings, and you want to pay your tithe, yes, Lord, if you want to pay your tithes and your offerings this morning, we want you to do that by Cash App, and that is $GiftOfLife 1651. So if you want to give in the Cash App, you may do that. If you have a credit card and say, Bishop and Pastor, I just don't trust all of that, we have someone out in the Nortex who will swipe your card so that you can pay your tithes and your offerings there. If you're in the house and you have cash, we already sent out envelopes by the ushers. We want you to be obedient and put your tithing number or your giving number on that envelope. If you don't know what your giving number is and you are a regular member here, there's a sign out on the board that will tell you what your giving number is. Reason why we have a giving number is so that we can keep up with everything we need to keep up for bookkeeping. Amen. So be obedient and put your giving number on the envelope. If you're outside of this building and you say, Bishop and Pastor, I want to ride that money pie. I'm going to send somebody. We have someone in the Nortex that will be able to come out and get your tithe and your offering for you. If you say, Pastor, I don't want to do any of that but mail it in. We have that option as well. Please mail your tithes and your offerings to Post Office Box, well, Gift of Life Church, Post Office Box 362, Waterloo, Iowa, 50704. We gave you about four or five options on how to pay your tithes and your offerings this morning. And how many of you know that God doesn't want a begrudgingly giver? He wants a cheerful giver. So I need you to stand to your feet, get some happy feet in you, get some praise in your lips and some thank you Jesus in your mouth, and come on through, give us some happy good giving music so that the people of God can march on into their blessed place. Amen. How many of you know that when you pray your tithes and offering, you're marching into a blessed place? Amen. So please follow the directions of the ushers in the rear, and they will tell you how to get up here with your happy offering, being cheerful and telling God to have his way. Amen. Come on.
Thank you. anybody that can testify to what they're playing, that he gave you another chance.
Yes,
if there's a witness in the building,
yes,
come on, throw your hands up in the air and say thank you for one more chance. Come on now, put those hands together and bless the name of the Lord. Amen. What a presence of the Lord that is in this place.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I need you to fix this microphone because it's flat. It's strange. Don't want to have to work too hard. We thank God for each of you all that are here. And we thank God for what he has done for us. Because the truth of the matter is, God has done great things in our lives. Even though we are in the midst of some of the toughest situations that we've ever faced, we can still testify and say that God has done great things in our lives. Amen. Because I'm sitting up here on this pew this morning and I'm able to look at you and I'm able to listen, that means the Lord has done great things. Amen. Because I got from last Sunday to this Sunday, it means the Lord has done great things. Even though there's some struggles and even though there's some heartache, I can still declare that the Lord has done great things. Amen. Amen. And as Pastor Judea was talking about it, and she was saying, God have your way. Even after we declare that the Lord has still been good, we still have to tell him, listen, Lord, I still need you just to have your way. Because there are yet other things that I need you to work out and I need you to figure out and I need you to set straight for me. And I promise you, if you turn it over to him, he can handle it. He can deal with it. You know, he can deal with it. He can handle it. Look at somebody and tell them he can really handle it. But he's just waiting for you to get your hands off of him. He's waiting for you to leave it alone. He wants you just to leave it alone and then he's going to handle it. You hear me? He's waiting for you to leave it alone and then he's going to handle it. Because what I found out to be the truth is, a lot of times we still have our hand on it. And we are still mixing it. And we're still trying to deal with it. But he's saying, I'm just waiting for you to get your hands off of it. And if you leave it alone, I just want you to leave it with me. I just want you to lay it there at the altar. I just want you to leave it in prayer. And if you leave it alone, I promise you I'm going to handle it. And I promise you I'm going to sustain you until I handle it. Look at somebody and tell him he's going to sustain you until he handles it. You know, we're saying if he don't work this out right now, it's going to consume me. It's going to destroy me. But I want you to know right now, if you take your hands off of it, God is going to sustain you until he works it out. God will preserve you. God will rebuke the devil and make sure the devil don't go no farther until he works it out. Come on, somebody. If you really need him to work it out, I dare you to put your hands together and just give him praise for it. There's a song, keep playing it. There's a song, I heard this, it's the LaShawn Paces, the Pace sister's mother, and she would get on Facebook and she would sing this little song. You know, and I ain't that great of a songist, but I'll probably jack up something. But these little words of this song, they mean a whole lot. Oh, leave it alone. Leave it alone, leave it alone, leave it alone. God can't handle it better than you can. Leave it alone, oh, leave it alone, leave it alone, leave it alone, leave it alone. God can't handle it better than you can. Leave it alone. hands off of it. I'm done with it. There ain't nothing else I can do with it. I tried to work it out. I tried to figure it out. It has caused me to lose sleep. It has disrupted my peace. It has caused me to lose time. I've been so distracted with it that I couldn't handle my other situations. Stuff I should have been focused on, I couldn't focus on it because I was so consumed with it. But I'm taking my hands off of it. Because I know that he can handle it better than I can. Because he already has the answer. And he's just waiting for me to take my hands off of it. And the funny thing, as soon as you take your hands off of it, he knows it. All of a sudden, you'll find something tied up in the thickets. You'll find something. Something will come when the phone will ring. Somebody will come knocking on your door. You'll look at your email and the answer will be just right there. That's because you say, God, listen, I trust you. I trust you with this. I trust you with this. This is hard, but I trust you with it. As Abraham, he had to give him up. But I want you to understand, God had already had the answer. God had already had prepared the way. So we realize that God can handle it. If you have your Bibles, turn to 1 Corinthians, the 7th chapter, verse number 17. 1 Corinthians, the 7th chapter, verse number 17. I know you've been standing and sitting a lot, but we just want to honor the reading of the word of the Lord. And it is quick as you get it. If you could just stand to your feet for a moment. Grab your children and have them stand with you as we honor the reading of the word of the Lord. Thank God for every visitor that is in the building today. Thank you for coming and worshiping and fellowshipping with us, and even those that are by way of the virtual sanctuary that may be watching now or may be watching later. Thank you so much for joining us. And Pastor Judea has really covered all of that, so we thank you. Even in your giving, thank you so much. 1 Corinthians, the 7th chapter, verse number 17. And I'm reading from the Revised Standard Version because I liked how this was worded there. And it says, only let everyone lead the life which the Lord has assigned. Let's underline that word assigned. Assigned to him. And in which God has called him. This is my rule in all the churches.
Yes.
First, let me read it again. Only let everyone lead the life which the Lord has assigned to him and in which God has called him. This is my rule in all the churches. Father, thank you for the reading of your word. And thank you for your people, God, that have come.
Yes.
And they're awaiting, God, to hear from you. And so, Father, we pray now that you would amplify your voice, because your sheep know your voice, and another they will not follow.
Amen.
Father, we pray now that your word, which you have sent forth, and you have given it an assignment, we pray, Lord, that it will do what it was sent forth to do, God, and it will not return to you void or unaccomplished. Father, we thank you that you will focus our minds and our thoughts, God, that we can keep our minds stayed on you. God, that we'll be able to receive what you have for us. God, that will help us in the days to come. Father, we thank you that the enemy is now bound and rebuked. He is exposed, and every one of his assignments are canceled. In the name of Jesus, we thank you and we give you praise. Amen. Amen. You may have your seats in the presence of the Lord. Only let everyone lead the life which the Lord has assigned to him and in which God has called him. This is the rule in all the churches. I wish I could really take this text that I could have read it to you in its entirety, because it is a text that has a lot of information in it. But I don't have time to really get into all of that. But I want you to understand that this particular text, as it is written, it talks about every man, that everyone lead the life which the Lord has assigned to him. This passage of scripture is not calling us to be passive, because a lot of us will just say, well, this is what the Lord has assigned me to do, and I don't have to do anything else. It is not calling us to be passive or not to put forth some effort. Rather, it is reminding us that the Lord is the author of our life. If you look at that whole text, you will see that it deals with how God is the author of our lives and how he has designed our lives. And God, how God has assigned each of us a place in this life. I want you to understand that it is not by happenstance, or it is not at all by luck, that we are where we are and we are who we are. But it is by the sovereignty of God. It is by his will and his perfect planning that we are who we are, and we are where we are, and we are who we are. God's assignment simply means that, I want you to know that that means your nationality, your race, your sex, even where and when you were born were all decided by God. It was all decided by him. I had to be born on May 21st, 1968. That was all in the divine plan of God. I couldn't have come any sooner. I couldn't have come forth any quicker, but I had to come forth then. The Lord knew that I wouldn't survive probably in slavery times, because he knew how I was built up. I would have been whipped. I would have been, you understand, shackled and chained, because my mouth would have got the best of me. You understand? He knows when we needed to come forth.
Amen.
You are geographically assigned. He has assigned us geographically. Y'all, this part right here, it hit me hard. Because y'all know what my desire was. I wanted the Lord to make some changes and move me around and do some different things with my life. I had some different plans for my own life. But we are geographically assigned. This means there is a place, a city, a location where God wants you to be. I want you to understand, it ain't by happenstance that on this day, this is the sixth day of August 2023. I want you to know that it was in the divine plan of God that the people that are sitting here would be sitting here right now. Guess what? Wherever you're residing, you know, some of us have been like Jonah, and some of us have been like the prodigal son. We have gotten out of the places where God told us to go, and we have tried to escape and not go where God assigned us to go. But I come to find out, and I'm coming to realize, and I have to go ahead and give him praise, and I've just got to go ahead and say, yes, Lord, I don't like it, but the answer is still yes, that I'm geographically assigned to a particular area, because he knows what he wants to do with my life. He knows what he has assigned to my life. And so guess what? I have to be in Waterloo, Iowa, for whatever time that God has determined. I have to be right here. Look at somebody and tell them, I'm where God wants me to be. Even though I'm uncomfortable with it, even though I may not like it, because it's not where I saw myself, but it's where God has assigned me to be. Sometimes we just have got to become comfortable with where God has assigned us to be. You are specifically assigned. You are not wired to do just anything, but some things you are assigned to do well. There are things and giftings and talents that God has given to each of us, and it's been assigned to us. And guess what? Those are the things that you do well. And so it is important that we understand what God has purposed in our lives, so that we can persevere, and that we can strive to do and be the best at that which God has called us to do and what he has wired us and assigned us to do. And let me tell you, one of the worst things in the world to do is to try to forfeit what God has assigned you to do and pick up somebody else's assignment. If you try to be somebody else, you're going to fail miserably. And you're going to lead a miserable life if you try to be somebody that God did not assign you to be. Oh, it brings all kinds of torture. It brings all kinds of torment. And you will always try to compare yourself to somebody else. You will always feel that you are not good enough because you are trying to live out somebody else's assignment. So it is important that we establish the fact, what is an assignment? What is an assignment? What is an assignment? According to Merriam-Webster dictionary, an assignment implies a definite, limited task assigned by one in authority. An assignment implies a definite, is definite, limited task assigned by one in authority. So, as I shared with those people over at Impact, a person that assigns you something has to be in a place of authority. And they've got to have the ability, and they have to have the authority to assign something to your life. I think I gave them the analogy. If you send your child to school and that child is at school and there is a teacher in that classroom, that teacher has the authority to assign work to that student. And the responsibility of that student is, should be, to fulfill the assignment. And if they choose not to fulfill the assignment, then there's failure. But the teacher has the authority invested in them by the state because they have satisfied all of the requirements and they have done all of the things that they need to do to graduate and to receive licensure to be able to go into the school and to teach. They have the authority to give out an assignment. Much like we are, and we were created, the Bible says, the earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof and they that dwell therein. So guess what? We all belong to who? God. We have to understand that he fashioned us and he made us in his image and in his likeness. And so he knows who we are. He knows what we look like. He knows how we're wired. He knows what he has purposed. He knows why he even allowed us to be created. Because if he didn't want us to be created, guess what? We wouldn't have been. If he didn't want me here, guess what? My mother would have never met my father and I would have never made it here. But because God knows who I am, because he knows who I am, he has the authority to assign to my life what he wishes and what he, let me take that word out, wish. What he wills for my life, he has the authority to assign it to my life. And he did not, y'all know I like this phrase, he did not take counsel with me, nor did he ask me beforehand if I would do this. He didn't even ask my mother and my father. Whatever he assigned for my life, my mother and my father couldn't even thwart it. They couldn't even cancel it. Because it is because he is in the place of authority. Who is above God? Who is greater than our God? It is over in the book of Psalms 139, verses 13. Through 16, it reads like this. It says, you made all the delicate inner parts of my body, and you knit me together in my mother's womb. Thank you for making me so wonderfully complex. Your workmanship is marvelous. How well I know it. Verse 15. It says, you watched me as I was being formed in utter seclusion, as I was woven together in the dark of the womb. You saw me before I was born. Every day of my life was recorded where in your book. Every moment was laid out before a single day had passed. And so all of this time, I'm 55. For 55 years, even before I came forth, he knew me. He watched me be formed. He knew my days. He assigned things to my life. And I had to come into the knowledge of the assignment that God had placed upon my life. And the crazy thing is, even as I go now, I'm beginning to understand the assignment. I'm beginning to understand the things for which God has assigned to my life. And the thing about the assignment is, assignments can be rather challenging. Assignments, we don't like them too well, do we? Because when I love math, you can give me a math assignment and I'll do it. You can give me social studies and I'll do it. But when you start fooling around with English and science, I had a problem. I probably would do science, but that English, I hated it. I would have skipped that class, write a letter to get out of class. I'll tell on myself. I would do something so I did not have to go to that class because I did not like writing. I did not like trying to get my thoughts out on paper. If I wrote something, I just wanted to write it. I didn't want to put no period. I didn't want to put no comma. I didn't want to do any of that. I didn't want to check. I just want to spell the word the way I want to spell it. But then when you turn it into the authority, the teacher, and they send it back to you, they would tell you, listen, uh-uh. You thought, well, I done did the assignment. I should have got an A. But when I got the paper back, it was marked in red. I had an issue with it because they handed it back and you had to redo it because the assignment was not complete. Let me get ahead of myself. So assignments are not always comfortable. There are certain assignments even in life that we are comfortable with. There are things that God may ask us to do and we'll do them. But there are other things in life that if God asks us to do them, then I have a problem with what you just asked. I can't do that. I don't agree with that. I don't like it. Ask Jonah about it. He did not like the assignment that was given him by God to go to Nineveh. He thought that Nineveh should have never received the grace and the mercy of God. He thought that they needed to perish. But God, he got on a boat, decided to go his own direction and do his own thing. God sent the paper back and said, no, 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 it's marked in red. You did not complete the assignment. So you got to go back. You're going to go down. I'm going to bring you up. And when you come up out of that fish, I hope that you will complete the assignment. Has God ever assigned something to you and you just didn't agree? Can't agree with this assignment. But because God was the authority, he has the authority to will what he wants. And he has the authority to use who he wants to use. He has the authority to tell us what to do. And the thing is, if we choose not to do it, God is a patient man, isn't he? Because he's been waiting next in line on me for a long time in some areas because I didn't agree with the assignment. There are four characteristics to an assignment that I just want to run by you and then we're going to move on. I'm not going to be before you long. Four characteristics of an assignment and we're going to come back to them. First of all, what is the assignment? And it's funny because, let me put this out there. Sometimes God will send a message to you in two or three different ways, and he'll flip some words to gain so that people will understand. In essence, this talking about assignments is really a message on purpose, dealing with purpose. But he changes it to something that we can even understand the more. I don't know who needs to hear or who's going to listen, but it's going to bring understanding. First of all, what is the assignment? Secondly, what do you think of the assignment? Because what you think of it will determine how you respond to it. Isn't that the truth? Thirdly, what is the purpose of the assignment? And number four, the importance of the assignment. At some point, we're going to come back and we're going to address those things. But if you have your Bibles, flip to Jeremiah, the first chapter. Verse number four and verse number five. And it is Jeremiah so befitting to address this issue because God deals with him, and when he speaks to him, he goes clear down to when Jeremiah was a child, even before he came forth, much like what I read in Psalms 139. So Jeremiah, the first chapter, verses 4 through 5. I want you to know that Jeremiah is known as the weeping prophet. As I was studying this about Jeremiah, I read that those that studied this, a lot of rabbis would say that Jeremiah came out of the womb weeping. They said when, I forget who the painter was, when he painted on the Sistine Chapel, and he had painted a picture of Jeremiah, that on there, Jeremiah was slumped over, and it looked like on his face that he had been beat up because he had cried so much because he was weeping over the situation of Judea. And so he was known as the weeping prophet. He was a PK, he was a preacher's kid. His father was a priest. This prophet Jeremiah was sensitive, he was introspective, and he was probably shy, he served through three kings, served and suffered through the administration of three different kings. It is Jeremiah that was chosen by God. Let's read this. I'll read this text for you, and you will see what I'm talking about. So it's Jeremiah, the first chapter, verses 4 through verse 5. It says, "Then the word of the Lord came to me, saying," this is Jeremiah that is writing this. Jeremiah, the first chapter, verses 4 through 5. It says, "Then the word of the Lord came to me, saying, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you." So first of all, he's telling him, says, listen, I knew you before you were formed. You were already in my mind. I knew you. I knew you before your mama named you. I knew you. He goes on to say, before you were born, this is what he did. He said, I sanctified you. So before you came forth, I had already set you apart. And it had nothing to do with your mama and your daddy's background, whatever they might have been into. Because I want y'all to understand, people think that because they have parents that may not have been saved at the time, that there's no hope for them. I want you to understand, there have been some great folk that done came from some awful parents. And there are some awful folk that done came from some good folk.
Right.
He said, I sanctified you. I set you to the side. I had already marked you for myself. He says, I ordained you a prophet to the nations. So here, right here, he's already letting him know, listen, I've already got an assignment on you. So I'm getting ready to call you, but I want you to understand this call just didn't start when you became an adult. I started dealing with you. I had an assignment on your life because I was in authority. Because if I didn't allow you to be formed, you wouldn't have been formed. But I allowed you to be formed because I was going to raise up a prophet, and I was going to raise them up in a particular time and a particular place, and I was going to set them geographically. And so you're the one. So guess what? I've already ordained you. I knew you, and I already ordained you. I already sanctified you because I knew you. I put this assignment on you. I ordained you a prophet to the nations. So here's the assignment. You done called me to be a what? Now, I'm sure Jeremiah is sitting there thinking, now listen, my father's a priest. I know what they go through. I know what they deal with. You ain't called me to be nothing. Because if you look in the next sentence, when I told you, what do you think of the assignment? Here, Jeremiah is going to respond to this assignment that's being given him. He's getting ready to tell the one in authority, God, how he feels about this assignment. This is what he says. He says, then I, oh, Lord God. He starts with excuses immediately. He says, behold, I cannot speak. I can't speak. And he was getting ready to use his culture. Because the culture, you know, back then in those days, kids didn't have a voice. You know, growing up in my day, sometimes we didn't have a voice. You know, you lived in the house, whatever mama said is what it was. You didn't get to talk about it. If grandma said or mama said turn that TV off at 8 o'clock, you had to shut that TV off at 8 o'clock. If they tell you to go in there and put on a coat, you had to go in there and put on a coat. If they say you ain't going out this evening, you're not going out this evening. And there was no debate about it. We can't sit down and talk about it. We couldn't sit down and rationalize on it. We couldn't negotiate. Come on, somebody. We couldn't barter about it. It's what they said, it's what it was. And guess what? And if you kept doing it, or if you act like you didn't want to respond to it, or if you act like you didn't want to comply to it, or if you breathe too hard, or if you walk too hard, or if you close the door behind them because you were upset, guess what? So you would hear some footsteps come across the floor. Or they'd say, come here, boy. Because they were in authority, and we didn't have a voice at that time. So he's using, say, I can't speak. He said, for I am a youth. I'm a youth, so you couldn't possibly be giving me this type of an assignment. Help me understand this. You know, because some of us just talk to God like that. We're not disrespectful. We say, help me. Wait, hold up. Wait. Slow down. Pump your brakes. You said you knew me. I can accept that. Because you're God. You knew me. But then you tell me you ordained me. Uh-huh. Well, no, before you ordained me, you sanctified me. So you done set me to the side. I can even accept that. You knew me. You done put me over in this group. Oh, okay. But you said you ordained me to be a prophet. Huh? Now, I'm a youth, but I know what a prophet is. I heard my daddy teaching it in Bible study. All right.
I know what a prophet is, and you call me to be a prophet. I've been in church, and I've been around church, so I know what a prophet does. And you, me. Huh? No, I'm a, no, I can't talk. I ain't been to no seminary. I wasn't raised in church. No, can't no, me. No, I got some issues. See, I done some stuff. I done been some places. I been strung out. I done wrecked homes. Oh, come on, somebody. I done told some lies. I done stole. I was even stealing from you because I wasn't paying no tithes and offerings. Me? No. You can't. It can't be me that you called it. You didn't. Me? A prophet? No, because I ain't come from that. I don't even understand that. But me. But then verse number 7. He offered his feelings on the assignment.
It worked.
But the Lord responded to him. Sometimes God will respond to us and he'll engage in conversation with us. Other times he'll just skip over and say, listen, this is what it is. But he responds to him. He says, but the Lord said to me, do not say I am a youth. So immediately he corrected him. He shut him down. He said, now listen. Do not open up your mouth and say that you're a youth. Don't even say it. I need to know. I know who you are. I know how old you are. I know where you came from. I know what you did. You didn't think I knew what you did. You thought because the lights was off, I wasn't there, but I was there. You thought because you left the state that they couldn't see you, but I could see you. You thought because you put all that long hair on, put them nails on, changed your outfit, that they couldn't see you. They couldn't identify you, but I could identify you. Because I knew you. I sanctified you and I ordained you. Before you even came forth, I know who you are. Look at somebody and say, he knows who you are. He knows who you are. He knows where you came from. So don't say. Don't say. Don't say it. I'm going to ask you to say this one more time. Look at somebody, tell them, you got to stop offering the excuses now. You got to stop. You got to stop offering the excuses. After this morning, I want you to know, God said, I'm getting ready. You have to stop the excuses. You can't even offer another excuse. You can't offer another excuse. He said, I'm all knowing. I know everything that there is to know. I'm not present, but I know everything. I'm everywhere. My eye is everywhere. Because you can even make your bed in hell, and guess what? I'm there. You can take the wings and go to the uttermost part of the world, and guess what? Guess what? I'm there. You can go to a tribe, and they don't even speak your same language, but guess what? Guess what? I'm there. There's nowhere that you can get away from me.
That's right. Good, good. Amen.
So I'm here to tell you, he's removing excuses. He told you about this. Don't even say it no more. The Lord is saying to somebody this morning, don't say it no more. You keep offering him that. Yeah, let me back up and rephrase that. We can't say that no more. We know what I just said. We can't say that no more. We can't offer that excuse anymore because he said, I'm not listening to that because I already knew. I already knew you. I already knew you. I already knew you were going to struggle with this assignment. I already knew it. I knew you were going to have a problem with it. I knew you were going to struggle with it. I knew you were going to complain to me about it, Brian. I knew you were going to act a nut with me about this. I knew you were going to fight. You were going to complain. You were going to sit there and refuse to do anything. I already knew it. But guess what? Don't offer it no more. In essence, what the Lord tells him, he is, shut up. Do not say, I am a youth. Now listen here, he's coming back with him. He's reiterating the assignment to him. He says, for you shall go to all to whom I send you. He said, you're going to go to where I tell you to go. You got to go. You're going where I tell you. I'm going to send you to some people. I'm going to send you to some places. You've got to go. I want you to understand, when he sent him and he had to go. This prophet was going, and we understand everything that God speaks is not always judgment. So in part, part of his assignment, he sent him to go to people and to remind them of the promises of God and speak grace to the nations and proclaim to them, to proclaim to all the nations that they will gather in Jerusalem to honor the name of the Lord. So he would go and he would proclaim this to nations. But then in the same voice and in the same breath, he had to declare judgment to these nations. He had to declare judgment to these countries and to these cities. He had to declare judgment to them. He says, and you will go to whom I send you, and whatever I command you, you shall speak. And so let me tell you what we would have said. Okay, Lord, now what do you want me to speak though? What do you want me to speak though? What do you want me to say? Because we got some pastors right now. We got some preachers right now. I'm going to preach that which sounds good. Because it'll keep the offering. And it'll keep people coming. And it'll make me popular. But God is saying now, I ain't even gonna let that message come out. I come to find how God operates now. Some of this stuff, I ain't gonna even let it make sense to you until that morning. I'm gonna wait till you get in crunch and you ain't got no other choice but to just stand up. And when you stand up, then it all gonna make sense to you. When you stand up, then you're gonna start speaking. And when you stand there, then what I want to come out is going to come out. Because I don't want you to judge what I'm getting ready to speak to them. So there's something I need you to tell them. And so guess what? I'm going to wait. You'll get there and then you'll know what to say. When they come before you, then you'll know what to speak. That's some hard stuff, because we would have asked him. Because there's some things, like this message preaching right now. I was supposed to start this last week, but I couldn't get to it till today. Listen, it would have been easier for me to start last week. But today, he waited for today. His sovereignty. His sovereignty. He said, no, you let the pastor go ahead and do what she's going to do. And she's going to amen, amen, whatever it was that she was doing last week. Amen, amen. And everybody was with it. Amen, amen. Everybody was with it. He said, when you go out, who I send you to, I'm going to tell you what to speak, and you shall speak. And then this is the consolation that he offers him. This is the reward that he offers him in this assignment. He says, listen, do not be afraid of their faces. He said, for I am with you to deliver you, says the Lord. Because when you go, you're going to say some things that's going to upset some folk. They're going to get upset. They ain't going to like it. Because it's going to rock their ideology. It's going to rock their theology. It's going to rock their thoughts. It's going to rock their lives. It's going to bring conviction, and they're going to be mad at you about it. But don't worry about it. Because I got you. I have you. I just need you to do the assignment. You have no other option. There are things that are assigned to our lives. We have no other options. You got to do it. He ain't passing it on. I have asked the Lord to hand this over, to pass it on, move it to somebody else. I was on a council with other pastors here. Let one of them have it. Let one of them do it. I'll work with them. But when it was my time, let me out. Let me go. And he said, no, 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 no. Come on. Right here. My sovereignty said, you got to stay right here. You tried to leave once. I put you right in that little tan car and I sent you right back in. Because you stepped outside of my sovereignty. You stepped outside of my providence. You went somewhere I didn't tell you to go. It was nice, wasn't it? A nice vacation, and you went and you enjoyed yourself for a while. But I've got to send you back to the area, the place where I gave you the assignment. This is where I gave you the assignment. So go back to the assignment. Somebody in here needs to hear, it's time to go back to the assignment. It's time to get back to what God has assigned to your life. It's time to go. Come on, somebody. Anybody know what I'm talking about? It's time to go back to the assignment. You set the assignment aside so that you could do what you wanted to do. So you could do what you do it the way you wanted to do it. But God said, now, this day, I sent you here to let you know it's time to go back to the assignment. There's no other option. You got to go back and finish the assignment. Because it was assigned by one in authority. It was assigned by God. It was assigned by Him. And so Jeremiah is left on record as one of the greatest prophets, because he accepted the assignment. And near the end of Jeremiah's ministry, Jeremiah had pronounced a divine sentence of judgment upon every nation from Ammon to Babylon. This was the assignment that God gave him. Now you've got to understand your assignment. You've got to understand your assignment. That was Jeremiah's assignment. I have my assignment. You have your assignment. You got to know your assignment. What did he assign you? What did he assign you? We have people forfeiting assignments. Calling it retirement. Calling it sabbaticals. Calling it living my best life. Because if that's not the assignment that I gave you. What's your assignment? What did God assign you to do? I hear God. And you don't have to worry about having to try to get around somebody to get, I can't get my assignment done because of this person or because of that person. God said, don't you worry about that.
He's going to handle it.
I'll make the way. Your gift will make room for you. You got to know your assignment. What are you going to do with this assignment?
What you gonna do with it? How you gonna deal with this? Because today the Lord says, don't say that. Don't say it no more. Don't say it no more. That excuse is voided. You can't say it no more. You can't use it. I can't even use it no more. Veronica, I can't even use that excuse that I've been using with him. I can't. Yesterday I tried. Because the assignment was difficult. Yeah. The weekend, the assignment was hard. Yes. And I wanted. I said, Lord, just come in here. Because you know the Raiders, they can handle it. Let the power of God fall on them and so it can miss, it can skip over me and I wouldn't have to. The Lord said, that's your assignment. Yesterday at the end of the service, I thought, well, I just back up. And I'll just gracefully bow out. I heard the Spirit of the Lord say that on the inside. It's the assignment. Finish it. Finish it.
Get it done.
I know it's hard, but finish it. I had to finish. What's the assignment? What are you not trying to finish? What are you not trying to finish? Why are you not trying to finish it? I don't get it. I don't understand it. It's too hard. My strength is made perfect in your weakness. All you need to do is try. I'm not calling nobody out. But this is what I'm going to say to you. As we sit here and as we get ready to leave, you need to take some time and talk to God about your assignment. Let me tell you something that's so easy to do. It's easy to talk to somebody else about their assignment. But it's harder to deal with yourself about your own assignment. Because we have these feelings, I don't know who I'm talking to, of inadequacy. We have these feelings of low self-esteem, low self-confidence, feeling like we're not qualified, feeling like we're not good enough. Feeling like that, you know, our past is going to come up and it's going to, you know, make it hard for us. God knew your past. He knew your past. Before he gifted you, he knew what your past was going to be. He took it into account. He knew it all the time. But he said, this gift, this assignment, is without calling. It's without, this gift and this calling is without repentance. I'm going to do this regardless. And even if people hold it against them, guess what? I'm with them. And so they still gonna be effective. Have you ever met somebody, God has given them an assignment, and you try not to like them, but the only thing you can do is say, God sure enough used them. You couldn't do nothing but say, phew. And you may not admit it then because you're trying to front in front of everybody. That wasn't God. But then when you get to your car and you call somebody else that wasn't at church, because see, at church you had to keep up the front. But then when you get home and you call somebody else, you say, this lady at church, you know, I don't really like her, but that lady ministered to me today. She said something to me. They preached a message today that found me where I was, because they had an assignment and they executed it. And it mattered not if you liked them or not. God was with them.
That's
Look at somebody and tell them God's gonna be with you. Come on, point at somebody else and tell them God's gonna be with you. Just get the assignment done. Get it done. God is gonna be with you. God is going to be with you. Regardless of folk, if they like you or not, even if they don't show up, guess what? God is gonna be with you. Wherever thou goest, wherever I send you, I'm with you. But you just gotta get the assignment done. And so, this is kind of a personal thing that we have to deal with God ourselves. You know, it's not one of them altar things. It's one of the things you build your own altar. You know what I'm saying? You pull your own cloth up over your head. And y'all remember what I said yesterday? If you gotta do it all this way, get you something covered across your lap. Get your rag and lean forward and begin to talk to God. And then after you're done with it, like I told you yesterday, do like mother would do. She took the same thing that she used for war and for warfare. After a while, she pulled it out and she used it for victory. She began to wave and said, I done heard from the Lord. We got victory. I believe God. Talk to him about your assignment. Listen, there might be somebody standing to your feet that doesn't know Jesus as Lord and Savior. I want to extend this invitation to you today. This is your first assignment to get done. Is to give your life to Jesus Christ. If you're here today and you don't know Jesus as Lord and Savior, I extend to you this invitation to give your life to Jesus. Has it always been easy? No, it has not. But I'm here, I stand here and I tell you, he has never failed me. Been through some defeats, but God has never failed me. Had some losses, but God has never failed me. So if you're here today and you don't know Jesus as Lord and Savior, I extend to you this invitation. Won't you come? Give him your life. Secondly, there might be those in here today that you're backslidden. You forfeited the assignment God gave you for your life and you just decided, nah, this ain't for me. This ain't it. I can't. I'm tired. I'm ready to walk away. I'm done with this. This is too much. I just need to do me for now. If you're here today and you feel that and you know that that's you, I extend this invitation to you to come. Come on, clap your hands for this young man that's coming to you. Come on, son. Come on. Come on, man. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yo, there's some more folk in here that need to come this morning. I know it. Just like I look at this watch on my wrist. I know that you need to come. It's time to be restored. It's time. Don't leave here today and don't take full advantage of this opportunity. God is ready to restore you. God wants to restore unto you the joy of your salvation. God wants to restore to you peace. He wants to restore to you your purpose. You know that peace of mind that the enemy has taken away. God wants to restore it to you. But these are the blessings that come when you are in fellowship with God, when you are in right standings with God. You can reap these benefits. And I can say this, there are two people in here right now that still need to come. They still need to come. They still need to make the decision that this is the day. Yes, sir. Come on, brother. Clap your hands for this man that's coming. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. That's right. Y'all stand with these people. Yes, sir. Like, I'm not, I ain't in that big of a hurry. Y'all know how I wait. I'm trying to lose weight anyway, so I don't need to eat no how. Come on, baby, that's right. Come on, stand with yourself. Yeah. I'm waiting, I'm holding. Heaven is waiting on you. Heaven is waiting on you. It's too costly for you to leave here today and not make it right. It's too costly. I don't want you to get caught in eternity and you weren't prepared. That's right. Stand with him. Thank you so much. He's still waiting for you. He's still waiting for you. He's still waiting for you. That's right, baby. That's right. That's right. That's right. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. God is in the building. I want you to know he's in the building. Come on. I need a lady to stand with her. He's in the building. 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 That's right. Come on, stand with your dad and your grandma. That's right, son. That's right. you thought it's for your demise, but God said it's for your good. God said, I'm working. I'm working. I told you. What was meant for evil, God said, I'll turn it for your good. There are times of ministry that sometimes God won't let you move because he won't let you move because it's his time. And he's moving on the hearts of people.
Help me with my assignment.
Yes, Lord Jesus. And so I'm just,
I can't
I'm stalling. Because God is still moving on the hearts of people.
I can't fail you, Lord.
He's moving on the hearts of people. You so much. That's right, baby. That's it. That's it. That's it. That's it.
Put me back together.
one of you all that stand here. For every one of y'all that stand here. This is the day that God says, I put it in the plan of things for you to come and to hear what was said, because I want to reaffirm, I want to confirm some things in your life. I want to restore the stuff that life has depleted from you, the stuff that life has drained from you. I want to restore it. I want to pour back. I want to impart once again into your life. I want to reconfirm the assignment that I gave you. Yesterday, at the conclusion of that service, even before we got to that part, when I asked you for that chair, you took the same position that you had when Pastor Randy was still pastoring this church, and he would call you and you would come from that wall up to this altar. And then you went and sat down in the same seat where Providence Valley City, where you once sat. God said, that's the assignment I gave you. God said, it's time to pick up the assignment. It's time to finish what was started. I started a good work in you, and I am faithful to complete it. He hears you. There's nothing that you've done that God can't still use you. God is using broken stuff all the time. He mends it. He heals it. He puts it back together. It's that time. It's that time. God knows the struggles. He knows them. Those struggles don't scare God. God is able to deliver. And God said, while you're completing the assignment, I will deliver. Come on, Minister Harry. Come put your hands up. Is redeeming time with you. You hear me? What do you mean, Bishop? He's redeeming your time. God had and has a set plan for your life. Even what he said to Jeremiah, even before your mother brought you forth, you were already, he had already sanctified you. He had already ordained you, and he had already commissioned you. But he understands that you had to go down some roads. And because the road that you were going to go down, they were going to cause you to be beneficial in the kingdom, because it was going to cause you to be able to minister and to understand the hearts of people and to be able to minister to them effectively. And the enemy has been dead set that he will never let you reach what God has said. He's mad because you keep rising. Every time you fall, you get up. Every time you stumble, God picks you up. Every time everything is destroyed, God keeps building it back up. You've been ordained by God. But God has been bringing in the pieces. You hear me? He's been bringing in the pieces. And you thought this was going to be the thing that would wipe you out. Not so. This right here is fuel. This right here
is another testimony that you're going to use. Not only can you tell people God can deliver you, not only can you tell people God will keep you even when you lock down, but you'll be able to tell them, listen, God is a healer. I know what happened to me. They told me I wouldn't be able to walk. They told me how this was to come out. But God said, I will. I'm going to heal you. From the very crown of your head to the very soles of your feet, the devil is mad with you. He's mad with you. He's been mad with you. Keep him mad with you. Because as long as he's mad with you, guess what? That means I'm on the right side. That means I'm going in the right direction. So in the name of Jesus, tell me my time. So in the name of Jesus, I speak over your life. I speak divine healing in your body, in this name. You hear me? God is fixing stuff. God is healing stuff. Look here, your son's standing right behind you. You know the burden that you had in your heart for it. But guess what? God is starting a good work. He's getting ready to be eyewitness to what God is going to do in your life. You hear me? So guess what? He brought him here today so he can see the miracle working power of God. Remember what I told you, the song that I sung? Take your hands off of it. Let it go. What was the song we were singing? Leave it alone. Don't even worry about it now. I speak healing. Y'all stretch your hands towards my brother. He needs healing in his body. I speak healing to your Achilles. Achilles, God created you. And now we pray for a touch from the creator, from the master. God, touch this man's leg. You know what the doctors have had to say. God, you know what they think. But Father, we're more concerned about what you say. And God, you said that you took stripes that we might declare that by your stripes we are healed. And so Father, we thank you now that he is healed from the very crown of his head to the very sole of his feet. In the name of Jesus, God, we thank you for the miracle that you're about to bring into the life of this man. And God, that he'll be able to testify and tell what you have done. Thank you for the assignment on his life. Thank you that it shall be fulfilled. Thank you that it shall be completed in the name of Jesus. Thank you, God, now, God, that you're going to lift his spirit. Thank you for the garment of praise, for the spirit of heaviness. Thank you, God, that you got his mind guarded. You got his heart guarded. Thank you, God, that you shut down the mouth of the enemy in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Thank you for what you're doing in this house. Thank you for what you're doing in this house. From the mother to the son to the grandson. Thank you for what you're doing. In the name of Jesus. Thank you. Thank you for the healing. God, from the loss and from the pain. God, when they didn't even understand. Father, thank you for the healing right now. In the name of Jesus. And Father, that he will one day stand where I stand. And Father, he will do what I do in the name of Jesus. And God, that he will see lives change, that he'll see bodies healed in the name of Jesus, and he'll see lives snatched from the enemy. God, that he'll see those that are suicidal thrown off of the air, those that are incarcerated. God, their lives will be changed because of his testimony in the name of Jesus. It is so. Hey, Pablo, come on, check it out, fire. Yes, sir. It is so. And we thank you now for victory. In Jesus' name. Father, this mother needs a miracle in our eyes. God, you see and you know. God, you done brought miracles in our eyes so many times. God, you've opened blinded eyes. And so, Father, I thank you right now. God, that you would perform a miracle in this woman's eyes. Y'all know God can do miracles. And y'all know he can open up blinded eyes. And then he can turn situations around. Stretch a hand towards her. In the name of Jesus. God, we command right now God, that this woman's eyes be healed in the name of Jesus. God, when they go and look at him again, God, let it be in a better condition than what it was when they saw it the last time.